to your host, Anne Sheridan.
Thank you, Leo, and welcome to the launch of Minding Your Wellbeing online program. This is the first online mental health and wellbeing program developed by the HSE. My name is Anne Sheridan, and I'm the program manager for mental health and wellbeing in the HSE. And I'm really thrilled to see that so many of you could join us here this morning. In fact, over 1,200 people have registered for this event. And I think that's evidence just of how important mental health and wellbeing is to really to all of us at this time. Many of you who've joined us are our HSE colleagues, so you're really welcome. But equally welcome are all our colleagues and partners from community and voluntary organisations and from other workplaces. And no matter where you've joined from, you're very, very welcome. And I really hope that you'll find this morning's programme interesting, helpful and enjoyable. I suppose the truth is we are living through really uncharted times at the moment. I mean, this time last year, who could have imagined the 10 months that we've just lived through? There's a real understanding, I think, now of just how important the impacts really that COVID-19 have had on our mental health and wellbeing, and how important it is that we actively do what we can to mind our mental health and keep ourselves in good shape. Just last week, in fact, the government plan for living with COVID-19, resilience and recovery, was launched. And this is supported by a campaign called Keep Well. And many of you may have read some of the notices in the papers over the national media and or heard the ads on TV or radio. But essentially, that's a campaign that's there promoting everyday habits that we can all try to use that will help our physical health and well-being. Minding Your Wellbeing Online, this program that we're launching today, I'm happy to say really supports this campaign. So I'm going to ask Leo to put up on the screen now so that you can all see the programme, the lineup that we have for you this morning. We have a great lineup of speakers, and I think you're going to find the session really, really, really helpful. So we're going to start in a minute. I'll be introducing Dr. Stephanie O'Keefe. So I'm followed then by Teresa McElhinney. And I should say that some of the presentations are going to be pre-recorded and some are going to be live. So there's a blend of both in the morning. We're delighted that we have a joint launch of Minding Your Wellbeing Online by two ministers this morning. So you're going to hear from them later as well. And then some live presentations from both from Dr. Tony Bates, Dr. Zelda, Blasi and Dr. Mike Murphy. And followed then by live panel discussion. We've tried to leave a reasonable amount of time for that so that you have every opportunity to flag up any question that you'd like to address to any member of the panel. Leo has just mentioned the Q&A function. And so I'd really invite you to use that as much as you can over the length of the session. And I'll try in the panel discussion to address as many of your questions as possible to the panel. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Dr. Stephanie O'Keefe, who has pre-recorded her input this morning. Stephanie is the National Director for Strategic Planning and Transformation within the HSE.
Good morning, ministers, colleagues and attendees. I'm delighted to see so many people logging on today to the launch of Minding Your Wellbeing online programme. This is the first time that HSE Health and Wellbeing has developed an online programme focusing on positive mental health for the public. In 2015, I had the opportunity to develop a partnership with the positive psychology team in the University of Pennsylvania, led by the renowned psychologist Seligman. Through this partnership and with our Healthy Ireland team, we explored how we could best support mental health and well-being of people in Ireland using a positive approach based on the principles of positive psychology. The idea behind that being looking at a strengths-based approach of how you enable individuals and communities to thrive. And following on from this, we benefited from their guidance when developing the face-to-face Minding Your Wellbeing programme. The original Minding Your Wellbeing programme was developed in 2016. It's a one-day programme offered to HSE staff and other partners, including teachers. And to date, a total of 230 courses have been delivered by health promotion staff to more than 3,500 individuals. And I'm delighted to say that the programme that we are launching today has been put online it's no longer just a face-to-face programme. It's a series of online videos made by the Health and Wellbeing programme so that this programme is just more accessible to the public, particularly at this difficult time. And the focus is on the various elements of mental health and gives practical tips on how people can promote their own self-care and build their resilience. This is something we all need to get us through the rest of 2020 and indeed into 2021. As people look for more support in relation to their mental health and wellbeing, it's important that they have access to practical, evidence-based information. This programme is part of delivering our Healthy Ireland strategy and also implementing the Connecting for Life suicide prevention strategy. With an increasing need for the use and access to online supports and a move away from face-to-face training, it's really hoped that this programme will provide access and engagement for many people who wish to learn about how they can support their own mental wellbeing. There's no health without mental health, and many people focus on keeping themselves physically active and well, which is really important, but it's equally important that we're mentally fit, and this is where Minding Your Wellbeing comes in, encouraging people to reflect and practice ways to support their mental health. As the public continue to adapt their lifestyles to deal with COVID-19 and are faced with different challenges every day, this programme will provide the tools and supports to assist in maintaining a positive outlook. The programme doesn't aim to be a solution for people seeking support for mental health services, but it can provide many people with guidance and learning on how to support your own mental wellbeing. I'd like to thank my own health and wellbeing colleagues, in particular Teresa McElhinney and Fergal Fox, for working on the programme, our National Lead for Wellbeing, Anne Sheridan, and to all our staff and partners working at regional and local levels to provide services and programmes for people to support their mental wellbeing. I'd also like to thank the two ministers for being with us here today, helping us to support and to launch this online programme. Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much, Stephanie. So now I'd like to introduce my colleague, Teresa McElhinney, Senior Health Promotion Officer based down in Cork. And Teresa is going to give you an overview of the programme. Now, not only has Teresa been one of the original authors of Minding Your Wellbeing, but she's also the presenter of the programme on the five videos that Stephanie mentioned just now. It's been quite the journey, I think, she would testify to. But here to tell you about the programme in much more detail is Teresa. You're very welcome, Teresa.
Thanks very much. I just had a little bit of connection problem there just before you introduced me, so I hope that it stays okay and that you can hear me. I'm delighted to be introducing the online version of Minding Your Wellbeing because, as Anne said, I've been involved since the very beginning in developing the programme and coordinating the programme. And I suppose I am very aware of how beneficial the programme has been, how well received around the country it has been. So now that we've been able to adapt the programme to an online format, we're able to offer it out to a much wider audience. And what I want to do is just tell you a little bit about the programme. So I'm going to try and share my screen and hope that that works well. And let's just see if that is happening. Just give me just one moment here, please, and we'll get in there. So hopefully you can all hear me because I'm not quite sure whether my connection is working well. So let's just cross our fingers and hope that it is.
All good, Teresa, all good.
Oh, good. Thank you, Leo, for that. These things happen. As Stephanie said, the programme was developed around 2015, 2016. And because we had 3,500 people attending, we were able to undertake quite a solid evaluation of the programme. And that was done by the Institute of Technology in Carlow. And what we found, or one of the messages that came out of that evaluation, was that people, while they were aware they should mind their mental health, weren't really doing it, and found that so many things get in the way. And I'm sure we're all familiar with the challenges and difficulties that life can throw at us. We've got all of our responsibilities. We're trying to keep our plates spinning. And sometimes we just think, sure, we're grand, we're fine. And we don't really prioritize our mental health. So this program really is about inviting you very gently to give yourself permission to prioritize your own mental health and well-being. And the aim of the program is to encourage you to take a positive approach to your well-being. And that is really about building on what you're already doing well, building on your strengths, really focusing on your values, and working towards a positive outlook, really to enjoy life and make the most of it. And how we can do that really, and this is what the program focuses on, is prioritizing our self-care. And that is really building good habits every day, which we'll talk about in a moment when we talk about the program, that support our mental health and well-being. And also engaging in certain activities, which really is what the content of the program is about, excuse me, which helps to build our mental health. And just for a moment, because we are talking about good self-care, let's, if it's okay with you, to do a poll. And Earl, if you could just roll it there. About your own self-care at the moment, how would you rate your self-care at the moment? Could it do with a little bit of improvement? Or would you say it's going very well? So any time that you would like to vote, and we know there's other people in the world voting today as well, so we have our very own poll. And we'll come back to the results of that in a second. The program is focused on positive psychology. As Stephanie mentioned earlier on, we had done some work with Pennsylvania University, and they gave us some really good guidance around what we should be encouraging people to do. And positive psychology is underpinned by the idea that as human beings, we want to do what we can to thrive and to grow and to basically enjoy our lives. So I'm going to just move that off my screen. I hope you can still do it. Okay. Oh, we've already got the poll results. I wasn't expecting them quite soon. So a lot of us are saying that 82% of us that our self-care could do with some improvement. So you're in the right place, and you'll hear about a program which hopefully will help you to improve your self-care. And well done to those of you, 18%, who think your self-care is going really well. So hopefully that will last. The program is a broad-based program, and it really means that we take a universal approach to mental health. Because we know from research that no matter who we are or whether our mental health is good or not so good, we can all benefit from doing certain things to improve our mental health and well-being all of the time. And we're moving to the next slide. Okay. So in the program itself, as Stephanie mentioned earlier on, there are 5 sessions. So each of them, while they're standalone, they are connected. They do build on each other. So the best benefit is to complete the whole program. And I'll tell you a little bit about the content of it now and what we cover in each of the sessions. And we just go into the first one. Thank you, Leah, for your help. And the first is practicing self-care. And for those of us who think maybe that our self-care isn't doing so well at the moment, then this session might be a good place to start. So we focus on the different practices and habits that we can adopt every day to support our mental health and to develop what we call in the program our own self-care toolkit. And we've got the results of the poll. So 82% of us are hoping that we can improve our self-care. We know that our thoughts are really important when it comes to our mental health and well-being. And the reason why is, I suppose, that our thoughts impact on our feelings, on our behaviors, and generally how we view ourselves or see the world. So session 2 is about understanding our thoughts and how we can deal with negative thinking and how we can support positive thinking to improve our mental health and well-being. And our third session looks at exploring emotions. So it helps us to work with our challenge and emotions, to reduce the challenge and emotions, or to cope with them when they do happen. And they can happen, life can throw us curveballs. And also to build positive emotions, which we all want to have in our lives as well. So that is what we're covering in our third session. And our fourth session is around building positive relationships. There's a wealth of information about the benefit of having good relationships in our lives. So this session invites us to invest in our relationships, to nourish them and to nurture them, to improve our mental health and well-being. And there is one thing that does underpin all of our mental health, and that is our resilience. So in session five, we look at how we can improve our resilience through using the building blocks of resilience, and you can see them on the screen there, and how we can generally build that into our everyday lives, or build those building blocks and improve them in our everyday lives to support our resilience. And our next slide is practicing self-care, understanding our thoughts, exploring our emotions, building positive relationships and improving our resilience. These are like the jigsaw pieces of our mental health and well-being, and bringing them all together really does support our overall well-being. So just to give you a taster of the program, it's like the world premiere, if you like. We're just going to show a short snip of the program.
Then, who is one of the main writers around mindfulness, would say, no matter where you go, there you are. So it means looking after yourself first. And what I'd say is being a good friend to yourself. And being a good friend to yourself means, first of all, looking after your well-being, looking after your physical and your emotional health. It also means being kind and compassionate to yourself, to turn off that self-critic if you notice that you're giving yourself a hard time when maybe you don't deserve it. Also to value who you are and what you do. And to notice and acknowledge the strengths that you have. And we're going to come back to those later on. And the other thing that's really important is to ask for help when you need it. You don't have to cope alone. And that's what positive relationships are about as well. Being a good friend to yourself means that you can be a good friend to other people. And that's the starting point of building positive relationships. We're often more compassionate and forgiving to others than we are to ourselves. How could you be kinder to yourself? How could you notice your strengths rather than your failings?
Thank you very much for your attention, and apologies now to Minister Feighan.
Hello, and thank you for giving me the opportunity, along with my colleague Minister Butler, to formally launch the Minding Your Wellbeing programme. I would like to thank and acknowledge the HSE's Health and Wellbeing Division for developing these videos, which encourage people to take a positive approach to their mental health. The launch of this resource is particularly timely as we all continue to struggle with the challenges forced upon us by COVID-19. Since the arrival of the pandemic, we have provided a range of information and support as part of In This Together communications campaign. Last week, we launched our new resilience campaign, which is aimed at giving our people the resources they need to adapt to the continuing challenges of living with COVID-19. The campaign focuses on a number of key themes. These are keeping active, staying connected, switching off, and being creative, eating well, and managing your mood. The managing your mood theme aims to support mental health, and this new HSE resource is an excellent addition to this range of supports available. I would encourage as many people as possible to log into the yourmentalhealth.ie website and begin using these videos. The areas covered by the Minding Your Wellbeing programme encourage participants to reflect and learn about how their thoughts and emotions impact on our well-being, and how our relationships need to be protected as they in turn protect our mental health. The programme invites participants to identify the different priorities they may need to take to nurture their resilience through self-care. It promotes the concept of a self-care toolkit, which we can use to prioritise areas we need to address for our mental well-being. For some, that might be improving their sleep routine. For others, maybe reducing their alcohol intake. For all of us, however, it will be about staying connected. During the first period of restrictions earlier in the year, we saw how Irish people not only supported their loved ones and their immediate families, but how they reached out to support their neighbours and those isolated or at risk of isolation in their communities. Maintaining that positive community approach is just as important now as it was then. As we face into the coming months, I would again urge everyone to make the fullest use possible of the supports available. I am confident that the Minding Your Wellbeing resource will be of enormous help to people, and I wish you every success with the campaign. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister Feighan. I think one of the other things we're discovering this morning is that one of the new challenges, I think, where we rely more and more on Zoom and just some of the things that can happen when we try to do some live broadcasts. But hopefully you all understand that we can't do anything about that. As I said earlier on, the programme today has been jointly launched by two ministers, so I'd now like to introduce Minister Mary Butler for her pre-recorded input.
As Minister for Mental Health and Older People, I would like to wholeheartedly welcome the Minding Your Wellbeing programme. Having online resources that are available 24 hours a day is a very valuable service, given the different circumstances people find themselves in. We have all faced very challenging times this year, and it can be difficult to stay positive when faced with big changes in your family, your social or your work circumstances. However, there is a great range of mental health supports available for those who need them. I want to particularly mention the HSE's mental health text line 50808, as well as yourmentalhealth.ie information line, which is 1-800-111-888. That's 1-800-111-888. The many people working on the front line of our health, social care and emergency services, as well as those caring for loved ones at home, have kept us going during these very challenging times. I would gently remind and encourage you all to keep minding your own well-being. Your well-being is as important as all of those you are working to protect and keep safe. In my role as Minister for Mental Health and Older People, I'm fully committed to enhancing mental health promotion supports across the whole population, as well as targeting priority groups who are at increased risk of mental health difficulties. The partnership between my department and the HSE Health and Wellbeing Division includes a focus on developing future mental health promotion initiatives. And we know that there are already many agencies delivering very positive supports alongside the HSE for different groups within our communities. I would like now to formally launch the Minding Your Wellbeing programme, and I invite you all to view the content online and commit to developing or building on your own self-care plan. Gaurav Mahagut.
Thank you very much, Minister Butler. So it's been great to have the endorsement and support of two ministers for this initiative today. And by the way, to access Minding Your Wellbeing online, this can be done through mentalhealth.ie. But I'll say that again at the end of the session today, just to make sure that everybody knows how to do that. So now I'd like to move on to our next speaker, who probably needs a little introduction. It's Dr. Tony Bates. Tony is Adjunct Professor of Psychology in UCD, but he's much better known to all of us as the founder of Jigsaw. Tony, you're very welcome. He's joining us this morning from his home in Sligo. So we're delighted that you can join us. Thank you.
Thank you, Anne. It's lovely to be here on this very special occasion. And hello to everyone out there whom I can't see. But your presence makes a difference to this whole thing. I suppose earlier this year, I can't precisely remember, what day it was, but we went to bed in one world and we woke up the next day in another. There was a new presence in our country, someone who, or something that was about to change all our lives. The shadow of COVID moved very rapidly across the land, and in the last 8-9 months, it has touched each and every one of our lives. We're all finding it hard, but some of us are finding it much, are suffering much more than others. The pandemic has turned up the heat in the lives of many people whose circumstances were already stressful and fraught with risk. Family systems that were already conflicted and tense, people burdened with debt and unable to meet obligations. And there's a sense now that the connections that we badly have needed in this time of vulnerability have been eroded, and it is harder and harder to draw on the strength of family and friends and loved ones and colleagues, who we now realize kind of kept us going. So whatever social cohesion we had, it's been strained with all of these restrictions. And perhaps some people pushed to their limit or acting out against themselves, against each other, in ways they never might have imagined. Most commentaries on public health restrictions include some cautionary note about our mental health. There is a recognition that grief and uncertainty and isolation and worry can be overwhelming. So we're constantly reminded to seek help if we need it. And that's good advice. But mental health is a very new concept in this country. It's only quite recently that we've made it a value in our society. Up to now, we had no language to acknowledge its importance. All we had was a dread of mental illness, which was to be avoided or kept secret at all costs. Not a word was our cultural mantra when it came to anything mental. And it's to our credit that we can talk about an issue that is fundamental to the quality of our lives now. But what does it mean to have good mental health? It's clearly something very personal. Perhaps it's what is most personal in our lives. And I think it's fair to say that for all of us, it's work in progress. The WHO describe mental health in terms of an ability to stand on your own 2 feet, feel confident about yourself, feel good about yourself, confident that you can cope with whatever storms life throws at you and make a solid contribution to society. And there are certainly moments when you feel this way. And if you're in such a moment, savor it and be grateful, enjoy it. But what about the person who is sad over some loss or angry at having the business they have built up for years and put their whole hearts into pulled out from under them? Or the health worker who is frightened that he or she might catch COVID and pass it on to a loved one? To promote good mental health in terms of positive mental states runs the risk of excluding a lot of people. Adolescents who struggle with shyness and insecurity. When my children complained of being shy and insecure, I said, you're meant to feel shy and insecure. This is the, you know, the experience of adolescence. People who care and feel disheartened by the persistence of social injustice and exploitation of the planet. Migrants and minorities who live with discrimination. Anyone who reacts with heartbreak and inconsolable grief to an understandable human loss. It seems to me that people with good mental health are above all open and attuned to reality. Depending on what's happening, feeling upset can be an appropriate response. Anger, sadness, fear, and frustration are part of a fully lived life for every human being. Good mental health is not about feeling good or feeling bad. It's about knowing what you're feeling and being able to, at any given moment, and being able to recognize how you are and ask yourself, what do I need right now? What would help right now? maybe I need a walk, or maybe I need to talk. These videos are like a recipe book, packed with tools and insights that can help us respond when we check in with ourselves and connect with how we are. Like any recipe book, we need to read them carefully and then go check in the fridge or the press to see what ingredients we have and what we're missing. We use what we have to make the recipe our own, and that's important. Over my lifetime as a psychologist, I found the most important ingredient, the most powerful mental health self-care tool is the breath. We know breathing is really good for our physical health, but it's also a huge help to anchoring us in the face of emotional storms. It settles us, calms us, it allows us to think more clearly about what we might need to do to make it through a difficult time. When I breathe in new life, and when I breathe and new possibilities, and I breathe out gratitude. I recommend you try breathing. It's really quite life-giving, actually. So minding our mental health is about reaching in and reaching out. We reach in by tuning into how we are and asking ourselves what we need to do. We reach out to others, to ordinary people who are part of our everyday lives, as well as those trusted people who are a lifeline for us and who can help us make sense of what may be difficult in our lives. To finish, I would like to do a little exercise to help you access your own inner voice and listen to what it's suggesting you need to do today, or might not, you might just to listen to yourself. I think a lot of mental health is we're trying to tune into ourselves, and a lot of people don't know they have an inner voice of wisdom and intelligence if they can just learn to trust in it more. But I want you to just this will be about 30 seconds or less. To make it easy, I'm going to ask Leo, would you be kind enough to volunteer do this with me, because it'll be more alive for me if you're part of it. Where are you?
Sure, Tony, I'm here now beside you. To the audience, I'm beside you.
Oh, that's great. I can only see me, which is not an easy thing. So I want you to pause for a moment, and I'd ask all of you to do this. And I want you to take a moment to imagine yourself 5 years down the road. You're well, you're sitting in a place that you like, you're safe, life is good. And that future self is very aware of you now and feels very friendly towards you and wants to be there for you. And what I'm asking is if they could send you a message down through the years to you right now, what would that person say?
Well,
and I'm going to give people, before you answer, thank you, Leo, but before you answer, I'm just going to give people 10 seconds. I'll watch the time, and just 10 seconds just to tune in to yourself, and then we'll hear from Leo. Okay. Thank you for doing that. Leo, did anything come to you?
I think I would like to tell myself to keep it going and it'll all be fine.
Okay, hang in there, yeah. And how does it feel to hear that message?
Reassuring.
Okay, yeah.
It would be great to hear that message.
Okay, that's wonderful, yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. All of you for doing that, and a big hug to you all, and stay well.
Tony, thank you so much for that really, really encouraging presentation, and that really hopeful exercise that I hope everybody had a chance to actually do, but I think it's a really great exercise to do, to kind of help shift us maybe from where we are right now. So thank you very much for that. So you as an audience will get a chance to hear more from Tony, because he's going to be part of the live panel discussion now shortly. So just moving on then, I'd like to now introduce our kind of final speakers for the morning. It's a joint presentation from Dr. Zelda de Blasi, who's co-director in the MA in Positive and Coaching Psychology in the School of Applied Psychology in UCC, and Dr. Mike Murphy, who's director of research in that same school down in UCC. So very much look forward to your joint presentation, and let's hope Zoom, etc., all holds up. So you're welcome, both of you. So Zelda, I think you're on first.
Thanks very much. And it's lovely to be here. I'm going to try and share my slides. See now. Okay, can you see these?
Yes. Yes, Zelda.
So first of all, what I would like to do is just briefly introduce you to the world of positive psychology by giving you a backdrop to traditional psychology and how it has tended to focus on historically on what's wrong, what's not working, how can we control or cure mental health issues like depression, anxiety, schizophrenia, and so on. And by doing that, psychology has actually made huge advances in the way that we diagnose and in the way that we treat mental issues. But it generally tended to ignore what's good or what's working and what with the role of positive states in our mental health. So the question is, what happens when we take a positive approach to our well-being? And it's interesting to see that when we look at the role of happiness, joy, compassion, love, gratitude, and we see, well, what impact that these have on mental health, positive psychology is the field that developed in around the year 2000 by Professor Martin Seligman that started to look at that by using evidence-based modalities to evaluate the effectiveness of, say, practicing gratitude or best possible self, like the exercise which we just did with Tony, and seeing what effect does that have on our well-being. And the findings have been quite extraordinary, because when we shift the focus on what's good, what's working, what strengths we have, when we do that, we find that it actually has a huge impact on lots of different aspects. So just to give you an idea, when we are stressed, our thinking tends to be very narrow, because we're trying to deal with that challenge, that threat, so that we need to, you know, the flight fight response. But when we're in a positive state, when we're breathing, when we're being mindful, when we're connecting with feelings like gratitude, suddenly our thinking becomes broader, and we're able to be more creative and more insightful, and we can make connections, and we can see more, a little bit like the exercise of visualizing the best self in the future. And we're able to see actually that we can be a lot more wise, more compassionate with ourselves, and more optimistic as we do that. We can also connect with our sense of humor, for example, and that can help build resources from social support, for example, which is really important in our well-being. We can actually also learn, and we can adapt more effectively. We become more flexible, more resilient. It is amazing to see the research behind this, but the more we can connect with that state of positive being, whether it's through positive emotions or reframing something in a more positive way. So, you know, that could be through reframing stress as something that's going to be really helpful so that we can perform at our very best. That can actually boost our immune system. It can actually protect us, which is really interesting if we think about something like the current pandemic. If we want to, you know, boost our immune system, the more we are able to shift into positive states, and know actually that these can also coexist with negative, the more we're able to improve our immune system, which is really important if we want to stay well, and also increase our resilience. So we're able to bounce back faster when we're exposed to stressful events, which are, you know, pretty normal in this day and age, especially with technology failing relatively constantly. And it can also help improve our performance, which then allows us to feel like more satisfied with our lives in general. These are just some of the kind of areas that positive psychology has tended to focus its energies and research on, to evaluate, well, what is the role of those positive emotions, and what is the role of appraising things in a more positive way, so that we can then be healthier and happier, and actually there's lots of research to show this actually it improves our life expectancy, so our survival rate is better when we experience more positive emotions. So when we look at this particular symbol that you might be familiar with, the Chinese symbol, it reminds us that we can choose to turn a crisis into an opportunity or into a negative experience. So when we think about the current pandemic, it's about thinking, okay, so how can we look at this, not from a deficit kind of negative biased kind of way, but in a more almost post-traumatic growth. How can we use this time so that we can actually grow from this? And this reminds me of Viktor Frankl's Man's Search for Meaning, very famous quote, between a stimulus and a response, there is a space. And in that space is our power to choose our response. And in our response lies our growth and our freedom. So it's about remembering that we have a choice in terms of how we react or respond to the current pandemic, and having the resource that's been just launched today in this, from the health service executive in this program, lots of opportunities to learn how we might do that and improve our self-care. And I'm going to pass you on to my colleague Mike now, who'll talk to you a little bit more about an area of positive psychology. So thank you for that. So, Mike, are you there? Yeah, great.
If you just unmute there, Mike, please.
Perfect, thank you. Is the slide appearing on the screen?
Yes, all good.
Fantastic, that's great. Thanks very much. I just want to speak to you briefly, I guess, on the area of social engagement, which I think is a very important factor for us to consider at this point in time. When I speak on this topic, I usually begin by making the point that we've evolved to be a social species. When we consider evolution from the time of kind of ape-like creatures who were our ancestors many, many years ago, every evolutionary step that we see has occurred in the context of societies. We've lived together consistently. And it's fair to say that social engagement is a really important part of what it is to have the experience of being a human. You know, it's a consistent thing we see across the history of the species. Indeed, there's a reason that solitary confinement is used as a punishment, has been used as a punishment, and that's precisely because being alone is so uncomfortable and unpleasant an experience for humans. And there's a lot of research evidence that we can see that tells us about the relationship of social support to well-being. I won't go into huge detail, but there's really strong evidence to indicate that social support and social engagement can be very protective against the development of depression among people who do have mental health issues, such as depression or anxiety, for example. Having a higher amount of social support or a larger social network seems to be associated with better outcomes, people recovering more quickly and being less likely to relapse. And there's also evidence to indicate that social support and social engagement has an important impact on our physical well-being. Recovery from heart attack, for example, seems to be stronger in people with a stronger social network, as one case in point. There's a number of mechanisms through which social support can have that effect. One is what we call stress buffering, which we see particularly, I guess, in relation to physical health, where if we're experiencing stress, the the presence of social support can help us to cope with and deal with that stress and reduce its negative effects. And clearly, a period of a pandemic is a time when there would tend to be a heightened level of stress in society. Social support is also helpful to us from the point of view of giving us a sense of being valued, a reassurance that we have a worth, that we are understood, we're listened to, that people care about what we feel and what we're going through. And that kind of engagement with people can be really helpful and really beneficial from the point of view of well-being. And we consider that in the context that we're experiencing at the moment. Obviously, the pandemic is having a very pronounced effect on our ability to engage our social networks among people who are experiencing vulnerability or who are deemed part of a vulnerable group. Clearly, there's a recommendation to maintain as much of a distance physically from people as possible. And for everybody else, there are social restrictions in place. And that necessarily means that the way we would normally engage our social support networks has been cut across and impacted fairly heavily. And that can be seen then in the context of the data that we have in relation to well-being and to loneliness. The CSO released data they gathered in late April of this year in relation to people's well-being, and they compared it to results from 2 years previously. And what emerged, a number of findings, but far more people were reporting at least some experience of being downhearted or depressed in 2020 than they had been in 2018. And there was an increase in the amount of loneliness that people were reporting as well. And, you know, it's very plausible and reasonable to imagine that there's an association between the loneliness and the negative outcomes that that people were experiencing from the point of view of their mental health and well-being. And that brings me to, I suppose, the crucial point I wanted to make today, which is the importance of staying in touch at this time. We have a wide array of technological means of maintaining contact with people at this stage, going from the humble old-style fixed-line telephone all the way through to the kinds of platform that we're using here today, where we can have kind of visual engagement with people. It's not the way that we would normally maintain our social networks, and it maybe feels a little bit artificial, but I think it is really important to make those kinds of contacts. There is certainly research evidence again that shows that using online support or online methods of engaging with people is helpful and it is beneficial to us. So I'd say to anybody, if you're feeling things are tough, that you're finding it going a bit hard, it's a very good idea to reach out to people. Now, I say that in full awareness that people can find it difficult to reach out to others when they're experiencing difficult times in their lives. Sometimes people feel that they're being a burden on others, that they're imposing themselves on other people, that they're bothering other people. And realistically, when you're feeling down and seeing things in a negative light, that tends to generalize. So you see most things in a negative light. The truth is that for the most part, if you contact a friend, they're very happy to hear from you. And if they think you're a bit down, they're very happy to chat with you. It's also worth bearing in mind that the person you're contacting could very well be feeling the need of social contact too. That's likely to be a very, very common thing at this point in time. So, you know, in the event that you feel like you want to have a chat with somebody, I think, again, you know, use the resources that are there and reach out and maintain that contact with people. And finally, if you're doing well, and I know a decent proportion of the people who responded to the poll today say they are doing well and that they're feel that their self-care is going very well, you know, under those circumstances, it's worth considering maybe thinking about who in your social network might be a bit vulnerable and mightn't be doing so well, and maybe picking up the phone or contacting them online or something like that, and trying to maintain those networks, because they're healthy and they're important for everyone, and a very important part, I would say, of self-care. So that's really what I wanted to say, and I'll hand you back to Anne now.
Thank you, Mike, and thank you, Zelda, for giving us really, I suppose, the science and the research, I think, behind the importance of focusing on positive emotions and in relationships. And just that message, Mike, there at the end, to just kind of stay in touch and to keep in touch and to reach out to people around us. And also the fact that all of this has mental health benefits, but also has a lot, a whole range of physical benefits as well. So there's, it's a complete win-win really for us to really practice some of these very, very ordinary skills that we all have. We're going to move on now to the panel discussion. So I'd like to welcome to the panel those of you who have already spoken this morning. So Mike, Zelda, and Tony, and Teresa. And I'd like to give a special welcome then to two faces that you haven't seen this morning yet. And that's Dr. Sinead Reynolds, who is General Manager for Mental Health Operations and Planning, and Nodlaig Carroll, Organisational Health Lead, Workplace Health and Wellbeing Unit, both in the HSE. So you're both particularly welcome at this point. So can we get you all up on screen? Is everybody there? I might just say at this point as well, to access Minding Your Wellbeing online, you can do that through yourmentalhealth.ie. I might have mentioned that incorrectly earlier on, so it's yourmentalhealth.ie. Okay, so have we got everyone there? Nodlaig and Sinead. Yeah, okay, great. Okay, welcome everybody. So look, thanks to everybody who's been logging in some questions in the Q&A function. So we'll come on to some of those as we go. But I'm going to start, just kick off with you, Nodlaig, if you don't mind, because quite a lot of staff, colleagues are on this webinar this morning. And I mean, there's no doubt that the staff of the health service and other frontline staff have had to work through very changed and very difficult circumstances in recent times. And what are you hearing in your role are the biggest factors impacting the mental health and wellbeing of health service staff at the moment? And how particularly has HR been responding?
Thank you very much, Anne, for having me on here. So in our unit, Workplace Health and Wellbeing Unit, we're a lead for the organisation in terms of safety, health and wellbeing of staff. So we would be inward for healthcare workers. And with the services we offer, occupational health, EAP, health and safety, and myself and organisation health. So our colleagues in OD and design in National HR done a survey earlier this summer from March up until May and asked over 7,000 of our healthcare staff questions around their experiences on that first initial phase of responding to the pandemic. And we know that our healthcare workers, and I know there's quite a lot of people on here now who are working in the healthcare sector, have been very much central to the response of this pandemic. And there was quite a good few of the positives around team and people feeling that they had more autonomy around decision making. But one of the areas that was of a lot of concern for a lot of people who responded was the burnout and the exhaustion. And the fact that when for a lot of healthcare staff when they went into this pandemic back in last March, they were going into it from normal living and normal life and normal work life. And that now it's the long term and now we're in the second surge. So it's that whole area of how do you keep going working at that level, because there was a lot expected of our healthcare workers in terms of that response, and people did deliver and had to very, very quickly overnight turn around and change and to work with that change. So there's two aspects to it. We also would have our EAP, and what they're seeing is a lot more around stress. And the staff feel they're exposed to a lot more stress. And also what Tony would have mentioned earlier there around the social networks aren't there that they had before, and trying to work with the demands that are placed with them at work and having those issues earlier on in pandemic around childcare. And when there is a lot of stress, then they're experiencing more issues around relationships and also interpersonal conflict. So there's a touch this really for all our participants here who work in the health sector. Self-care is so important. I'm delighted to see this program, Minding Your Wellbeing. The self-care is very much what each, every one of say our healthcare workers can practice themselves, which gives them that space and that time away from those pressures at work, away from the pressures of normal life, and to build up that kind of bank of energy. And that gives that body that chance to actually to remove themselves from all of their stressors and practicing self-care and allowing them then to actually to have the energy and to build on their resilience. And so from a self-care perspective, again, reaching out, what so many speakers have said here, and availing of all of them, including this program and all the supports that are there. If there is anyone then at any point who is feeling overwhelmed, and that even with practicing self-care that they get to a stage of where it becomes too much, the pressures at work, pressures at home is becoming too much, we have an EAP service, confidential free service, that is right across the sector, across the country. And again, any healthcare worker can avail of that service. And again, it's just really a confidential space to talk with someone about some of the issues that are arising for them, and then putting a plan together on it. The other part to it is, and I'm very conscious of it, that we have healthcare workers who are going into work environments that are high stress, high demand, and a lot is expected of them. And so in terms of that, we would very much look at the whole area of risk assessment. And we would really encourage a lot of workplaces to move more into the area of prevention, rather than waiting for issues to occur and then trying to deal with them. And workplace stress that is coming up quite a lot is a psychosocial hazard. It's recognised under the health and safety legislation. And we have our national policy, but we'd also expect all our services and our managers to conduct regular workplace stress risk assessments. Now, in saying that, that actually is quite a lot, and that seems like a very complex process, but it's not. We have our health and safety team who've developed risk assessment tools, and they're available. They have a help desk line, 1850 420 420. Any manager or any service area can contact them for guidance and support how to conduct the risk assessment. And what I would say to services out there and for healthcare workers, conducting the risk assessment on workplace stress in your area, what it allows for is allows a conversation to take place. It allows everyone collectively to start looking at what are the issues that are arising around workplace stress, getting that conversation going. A lot of managers that were referring to me looking for supports often find that they have to have the answers. And the risk assessment means they don't have the answers. They actually are talking to their staff, reaching out to their teams and their staff and asking them through a risk assessment, what are the issues here and how can we actually work on those? It also allows services and areas to realise then when they bring up a lot of those issues that are concerning to them or their pressures they're experiencing around workplace stress, they are actually able to identify what areas they have control over and what aspects of the work they don't. And we know in healthcare, a lot of decisions are made maybe at a distance that can impact directly in service areas. But often when I go into service, when I say to them, when you close that front door, what it is that you do together that can actually improve your own well-being and reduce your own stressors. So how they work together, how they interact with each other, how they communicate, all of those things are within their power and within their own sense of control. And that's what it allows for. So really, it's a two-way in the workplace. Sure. Yeah.
No, thanks for that. I mean, it's really good, I think, for staff to hear that there are a range of supports there available through HR. But I suppose central to this is back to a point Tony was making, which is the importance of just tuning in to yourself at first of all, in terms of just how you are, what you need, and then knowing where you can get what you need when you do. Sinead, I might come to you for a moment, because yourmentalhealth.ie has a range of other supports that it would be good for people to know about. So can you tell us a little bit about what's available there?
Yeah, I can, certainly. I suppose just to start by saying, on that theme of tuning into yourself, I suppose what we're hearing from people on the ground now is that it's getting harder, that this was easier when it was when it was March and April, when it was coming into the summer, but now it's winter, people are tired. You know, at the beginning, people were willing to go that extra mile, but that becomes much more difficult when this is ongoing for quite a long time. And things that we all know that we should be doing, like getting out in the open air and making sure we're getting out into nature, all of those things are much more difficult when the winter is coming. So I suppose they're the kind of things that we think are really important that people need to be thinking about, trying to make sure that they are minding themselves and they are getting out in the fresh air. And that's not just for your mental health, that's for your physical health and even your immune system as well. And I suppose COVID has really showed us that this idea of it's all in your head and the head and the body being separate is really a bit of a myth, really, because your body and your head are all very connected and they live in a culture, which is our culture at the moment, is one that's full of COVID, unfortunately. The other thing that people are saying to us now as well is that switching off is more difficult now. So we used to leave the office and go home, but now those edges are blurred a bit more and people are more likely to leave computers on, to check emails till all hours of the night, and they also have a much more limited social network. So they're the kind of things that we can do something about if we pay a little bit more attention into. So we can make sure we're switching off. We can make sure we're getting out into the air. So they're the kind of things that we need to be doing. Your mental health has lots of information. It has a comprehensive list of range of information about different mental health issues, including things about what to look out for and what you can do to help yourself or someone you care about. It also has contact details for HSE funded services and then for NGO services, which are generally at a much more population community based level. So more aligned to kind of the wellness and health and wellbeing part of the spectrum rather than severe mental illness. The Minister, Minister Butler, did mention your mental health and our free phone, which is 1-800-111-888. And you can call that to find out what mental health services are available to you. We also have some specific things that have been put in place due to the pandemic. So we have two new COVID psychological support modules which are available on the HSE website to support staff in terms of looking after your own well-being during COVID-19 and also as a manager for looking after the well-being of your staff. So what I think I'll do after today is put some links together and they can go out with the handouts from today with links to a number of different things. SilverCloud is another support that's been put in place. So there are self-help resources available now if you're a member of staff through SilverCloud, and we have links for that as well. So we'll put all of those links on the paperwork that goes out after today.
Okay, Sinead, thanks very much for that. So and yourmentalhealth.ie is an important go-to really for everybody, whether you're a staff member in the HSE or whether you're a member of the public. That's the place to go to find all the resources that Sinead has talked about there. Thank you very much. I just see one question coming in there that's interesting. And the question is coming in for as a manager. How can I incorporate kind of mental health and wellbeing into my manager? And I might come back to you, Nodlaig, just for a quick one on that. I mean, have you any thoughts on that?
Yeah, oftentimes we'd hear managers that they feel that they know and they decide what's best for the team. And so first of all, I'd start with that is actually going back to the team and asking them what it is that they'd like to have. And therefore, you know, then whatever they come up with, that then they're going to be engaged in it because you're actually meeting the needs of that team rather than you knowing and thinking that you know best what's for that team. So definitely there's lots of ideas there around it. And one of the things is what was mentioned here and your mind and your wellbeing program here, the different stages that you have around that self-care, around relationships, how you work together. All of those are just as important in a workplace setting, in a workplace environment, as it is in our personal lives. So for example, if people are working remotely now, it's important to actually have a plan as a manager in how to connect your team together. I know that it was mentioned numerous times there about people feeling isolated. As a manager, to look out for that and see, is there someone who's isolated in the team, but come up with other innovative ways of trying to connect that team together, sure. Whether it's okay. On a weekly basis, just meeting them or in a very informal way. But different things like sitting around together, moving away from work, even I hear of in service areas where people want their small kitchenette or the area that's going to be a safe space where they don't have to talk about work. So it's about incorporating all the wellbeing issues that you have here in your program into a workplace setting.
Okay, thanks. I mean, one of the things that I think is helpful that managers could do is whenever you're having a team meeting or whether you're doing a one-to-one supervision session, is that you have self-care on the agenda, that becomes part and parcel of the conversation that you're having with your team or with your colleagues that you're actually supporting. And I think that might help then as well to address the question, Tony, which you were talking about, which is the importance of tuning in. So can I go to you for a minute and just say, look, are we still reluctant to admit the impact or acknowledge when we're going through tough times? Is that still difficult for us to do, even to ourselves?
Yeah, and just before I answer that, I want to say shout out to Susan, who asked the question, how do we keep this language inclusive, you know, that it's about all of us, not them and us. And I just thought that was very important. And thank you, Susan, that question. So when I think of your question, and I think this is about all of us, I think that we are in a very unique set of circumstances. We're on territory that we've never been on before. And therefore we had no map for how to cope or for how to feel. And I think that many of us don't quite know how to find, don't have the language for it. I know myself, I was very vulnerable for a couple of months, and there was nothing wrong with me. I mean, nothing, you know, dramatically wrong. But I was feeling somehow a bit vulnerable, and I kind of found it hard even to say that, you know, to myself. So, you know, when I did say it, and I said it to other people, you know, I said it to one or two, I probably shouldn't have said it to, but, you know, so choose who you talk to. But I, you know, I felt much better. So I think that, you know, the research has shown that there's a whole cohort of people within the population who will be particularly affected by what's happening. These are people who coped fine all their lives. They've never had a mental health big issue. And suddenly they have huge loss or grief or livelihoods are taken away. And they have the rug pulled from under them, and they don't know what to do. And they probably do lots of things that are not so smart. But, you know, they are trying to find a language. And these are people that research has said are only very slowly become obvious. The guy who says, or the woman who says, you know, I'm having a crap time, is lucky, okay? They are the lucky ones. They know how they're feeling, and they're saying it, and they can immediately begin to engage with something that they've already started to do something helpful on their own behalf. But it's the person who's sort of simmering quietly and doesn't know how to say how they feel, but somehow they have a lack of confidence, or they're not sleeping, or they're feeling defensive about life generally. These are the ones I am concerned about, and their problems or their emotional experiences only come to light as time goes on. Research would say for about 18 months after a major pandemic like this or major natural disaster. So I just think, you know, being very sensitive to people, first of all, that everybody's hurting. You know, they don't imagine for a moment that anybody's getting off scot-free. Even the ones who are saying, I love this, it suits me, it's great. They're hurting in some ways. They have lack of communication. Grandchildren, they've, you know, they have to wear masks, they can't go shopping as freely, whatever. Everybody is getting it. And some people, you know, are struggling with how to say that. Just because they're not saying it doesn't mean everything's rosy. I'm not trying to patronize people, but I'm just saying that. Yeah. I think it's no harm to just be even a little bit kinder to somebody who's, you know, the neighbor who talks too much, or kind of, you know, you try to avoid on the street, and you might be out for your 2 meter walk or wherever it is. And, you know, but actually just think for a moment, you know, they're perhaps having a harder time than they could possibly tell you, even if you had that kind of relationship with them, which you don't. But they need contact. We're social beings, and we need contact, not a therapist necessarily, although they can be very important, but low grade human contact. I feel a great sense of belonging out here with the staff and super value, with the postman, with the, you know, the neighbors I don't know very personally, but always say hello to. And, you know, we all need that sense of belonging, and we need to move out of ourselves when we're languishing in a place that we are finding ourselves getting stuck, you know. Be aware of that. If you're, you know, madly depressed or furiously angry, that's much healthier. But if you're very flat and stuck, be careful, you know, I would say.
Thanks, Tony. And I think just that question that we can ask of each other, you know, how are you doing?
Yeah.
Just kind of opens up the possibility at the end
to
begin to maybe acknowledge how they're feeling. I might go, thanks, Tony. I'll go to Zelda or Mike at the moment. I mean, I'm just thinking about the positive psychology science that you've been talking about there. And I mean, I know the science is getting stronger all the time, but optimism seems to be a really key element of positive psychology. And I just wanted to ask you, how can we stay optimistic in the times that we're in? What helps us do that? You're mute, Zelda?
Yeah. So yeah, I might say a few things about that. Mike might have something else to add to it. So I suppose one thing is to be realistically optimistic as opposed to unrealistically optimistic, because if we're too optimistic, we wouldn't, you know, take the precautions that we need to take during this pandemic. And the other thing is practicing certain things like the best self-exercise that we did with Tony. I think that's a really useful one. I think the biggest aspect of this is learning to practice tools, techniques, exercises. It's almost like we have to bring ourselves to a gym, if you can think of that. And because we're going through this second wave that's causing a lot of exhaustion, I think the other part of this is also to realize we're training for a marathon here. So we're actually having to bring almost extreme forms of self-care into our daily lives, so that we can manage to survive and maybe even thrive during this period. So I think being optimistic, one thing I would say also along this line is to kind of bring what the pandemic has done is brought us to the present moment, very much so. So that maybe things that we were looking forward to have been canceled, like mm-hmm. children's communions, holidays, all these kind of things. We can't really predict things as such, but what we can do is be in the present, make sure that we do what we can do to mind ourselves. And then the other thing is to visualize a best possible self in the future and use our imagination and use our creativity so that can help us move along. So I don't know if Mike has something else to add to this.
Thanks, Zelda.
Thank you.
Thanks, Zelda. Yeah, I mean, there are a couple of things I think that you can do to try and increase your level of optimism. Oftentimes we can find ourselves reflecting negatively on things and kind of seeing, you know, the negative side of experiences that we've had. And if you can spot that pattern and that you're engaging in that way, then you can kind of cut across it and ask yourself, am I being realistic here? You know, is this a reasonable way of interpreting what's happened? Can I see a positive side to things? Is it possible to see that there's something here that isn't entirely negative? Because we can get into patterns of thinking and we can immediately go down the track of the negative thought without even necessarily realizing that we're doing it. And if we can be aware of that, we can kind of cut across it a little bit and try and find alternative ways of looking at things. I think at a time of pandemic as well, obviously it's not something we have experienced previously, but we can look to the experience of history and we can see that pandemics end, that, you know, that there's a process which goes on for a period which can be really, you know, to one degree or another, very, very unpleasant and very unsettling and very difficult. But, you know, whether you're talking about pandemics, whether you're talking about wars, whether you're talking about periods of famine, they do end. And, you know, this is presumably not a state of affairs that's going to exist indefinitely. And I think it's important to try and maintain that kind of a sense as well, that although we might not see the light at the end of the tunnel, that the tunnel does have an end.
Thanks. Yeah. Okay. That's great, Mike. Teresa, we're talking here a lot about actually a lot of the elements that make up the Minding Your Wellbeing online program. Mm-hmm. So I might get you to talk to this for a little minute. And also, I just noticed in the questions in the Q&A that there's been a number of questions around, you know, whether this is a program is the program suitable for older people, mm-hmm. for other population groups, and all the rest. I might ask you just to address that. And any plans around the future development of Minding Your Wellbeing?
Thanks, Anne. I suppose the program has been evolving since we developed it, and obviously the online version is our latest version of it. But we are very aware that not everyone has access to technology, not everyone can use online platforms. And I suppose that the term digital poverty comes to mind. But we are looking at how we can make it available to a wider audience. As I said earlier on, we've taken a universal approach, so it is quite broad, but the key messages apply to all of us. And during the summer, Anne, you'll remember that yourself and myself consulted with groups of older people when we were trying to see how we could, say, offer the programme to older people or to different population groups. And I use the word older people in the broadest term because we were, with the people we spoke to, they very clearly told us that older people are different. They're not all the same. They have different levels of ability and interests, particularly when it comes to technology. But what they did say was for some older people who aren't comfortable with technology, that say, for instance, a radio program or something they could listen to in their own homes or in a nursing home would be very useful. So obviously, if we're doing that, we would be involving older people themselves and people who know older people to maybe go into partnership to adapt the key messages to go in an audio version, maybe with local radio, so that people can access it who aren't able to access it online. It is something that we do want to make available to a wide audience. So we will be consulting with other groups as to what are the best methodologies. How do people pick up health messages? What would be most beneficial, for different population groups? So that will be something we hope to work on. We're also looking at trying to put maybe some resources online as well. For instance, we talk about the self-care toolkit, and if we can put something online that people can download and print off and share around monitoring our self-care. So that's what we're looking at the minute, but we do hope to use these messages and get them out to a wider audience, but it will take a little bit of time to work out how that is best done.
Okay, thanks, Teresa. Thank you. Just staying with older people for the moment, as Teresa mentioned, we had an opportunity earlier on in the summer to talk with some older people. And one of the things that was really interesting that they said to us was that they had begun to internalize this message of vulnerability and being at risk. And that in some way was, you know, very quite unhelpful. I'm just wondering if any of you would be interested in commenting on that. I mean, you know, how can they hear the message without that defining them or without them owning that? Tony, I might go to you first on that.
Yes, I think we're much better this time around. I agree. Older people some freedom of choice around their own movement and that. It's not true to say that they're having the worst time. You know, it's not. Studies in Australia show that one study I'm thinking of, quite a well carried out study, 3,000 people. And they found that in terms of how severely stressed they were feeling, and the millennials, those, you know, 18 to 40 year olds, they were having a really hard time. They were having the hardest time. About 60% of them said they were very stressed. A lot of younger people were having a harder time, maybe 20-30%. They only found 7% of the older people said they were severely stressed. Now, there's a number of other studies that are not quite as dramatic as that, but they show that we need to be very cautious about assuming older people are having a harder time. So that's the first thing, is that they have resources, you see, in themselves to draw on. You know, they have fairly well-established support systems like the radio, which has been terrific, I think, in terms of helping the whole population get through this thing. And they have, you know, contacts with children, grandchildren. They have people who are coming at them. There are some who don't, and we have to be conscious of those. I have a neighbour here who's 78, and just, you know, I just check in with her. She's on her own, and I had a phone call from her last week, and I said, "Oh my God, what's wrong with her?" And she said, "I haven't seen you, Tony. I'm just seeing, are you okay?" So, you know, it's also giving them a role in looking after us and guiding us. Their health is clearly perhaps more vulnerable were they to get COVID, and that's a reality, and it's something we and they need to be aware of. But it doesn't mean I stop living, or my living isn't any less rich because I'm facing that. I'm still a person, I still have needs, and I don't want to be seen as a cocooned health risk. You know, I want to be seen as a person. So I am I don't know. I'd ask them what they need, but I just, and can I just say something else? And I hadn't said it, but it's funny, we're, in a funny way, we're paying very little attention to the program we're launching here today. And I think it's because the authors of the program are very naturally quite humble and don't put themselves forward. But, you know, the program, it's not just that it's covering a lot of important information, but I would really like to comment on the language that is used in the program. It's very user-friendly to any age group. And even more important than that, the tone of voice is really, it's tender. It's not judgmental. It's not prescriptive. And I think that's very hard to get right. So I just want to pay a compliment to all of you who worked so hard to get this right.
Thanks, Tony, for that. Thank you. One final question maybe, and it's just come in and I see it on the Q&A, and I'll just put it out there because it is quite, I think, fundamental. How do we address the gap between knowledge and action? A lot of us know what to do, but to just get ourselves motivated and to actually applying what we know, that sometimes can be really, really hard. And Teresa, I might give you a chance to address that from, you know, for people even, I'm just even thinking in terms of Minding Your Wellbeing, people who are in that slump, for even to go and actually watch the videos might take a lot of effort. What would you say to them?
Okay. Well, I suppose I can speak personally here for myself. And I know that if I wait until I feel like doing something, often I don't do it. Sometimes I just need to jump in there and do it. Because often we get motivated after we've started doing something. So what I would say there, the program is really about encouraging you, not forcing or lecturing, but encouraging you just to take small steps. So even if it is about saying you're going to take a 5-minute walk, and then when you get out there, you might end up taking a 10-minute walk. So it is about making it doable, not overwhelming, not putting too much pressure on yourself, not filling things with shoulds and musts, but making a choice and saying, I choose to mind myself, I'll do it in small ways, and then hopefully you'll become more motivated to do something on a grander scale. So small steps.
So being realistic and just
realistic.
Starting small.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Anybody else in the panel want to comment on that?
Yeah, Anne. I would say is, you choose to, if you don't choose to make a decision about something, it stays as it is. You know, so if you're struggling at the moment, or that you've that you can improve things, that's a choice you make. It stays as it is. Nothing's going to change. So there is, you know, take that risk, take that chance to just maybe try and slowly, as Teresa was saying, now take the few steps. Otherwise, nothing changes. And what you're experiencing, and if you're experiencing and it's a bit negative, it's not going to change. It's going to stay like that. And it's the same in the work environment. If there's a lot of negativity, if there's a lot of issues, if there's a lot of stress, doing nothing, it's going to stay like that. It makes a difference, you know. So I suppose it's kind of recognizing that I stay as I am, nothing's going to change, or I take small steps and then I'll see the positives.
Okay, thanks. And I mean, look, at the end of the day, it starts with yourself, doesn't it? I mean, just that acknowledgement to yourself. And we can all find that hard to do sometimes. If we're feeling under the weather, even to acknowledge that to ourselves. But that's the first thing, I suppose, because once you've done that and acknowledged that, then it's much easier maybe to think about, okay, well, what do I need to do about that? And that's where Minding Your Wellbeing comes in, that the program does, I think, provide a lot of information and a lot of very practical strategies and tips that people can just integrate into their lives to make habits out of doing some of the things that we know are really good for your mental health and wellbeing. I'm just aware of the time, folks. I would just like to, first of all, thank all of you from the panel and all of you who've been presenting here today. That's been a really fascinating and really, hopefully, very worthwhile conversation for everyone who's tuned in. I'd like also to thank a few other people. To my health and wellbeing colleagues, especially Fergal Fox, whose support has been hugely valuable in reaching this milestone today. To Noreen Turley and Eamon Kyo for all the communication support and getting the information out there about today. Look at the numbers of people who participated. It's fantastic. To Leo and Earl from Integrated Media Solutions, you completely deliver on what you say, which is take the stress out of these events. And so thank you for doing that today. Even when slides weren't working, you were there in the background to fix them. So thank you very much for that. GK Media are the company who have put together the videos that you're going to watch. And so Gary and Damien, who are in that company, who just worked tirelessly and very patiently with us around this program to get it to being in the best shape it can be in terms of launching that today. And finally, the final word needs to go to Teresa McElhinney, whom you will all get to know Teresa very well now when you get a chance to look at the videos. And I can't really describe the extent of work and commitment that Teresa has brought to this, but I think when you look at the videos and imagine yourself being the person that you're looking at, yourself and having to stand up and do what she did. So you did a fantastic job, Teresa. So thank you very much to that. Finally, I'd like to just thank every one of you who've tuned in here today, this morning, and I really hope that you found the session helpful, that you found some interesting, piece of information and just some encouragement. I mean, I think if I was thinking of anything that I'd like people to get from this morning, it is that encouragement to stick with it and to do what you can to mind your mental health and wellbeing, in the knowledge that there is no one who hasn't been impacted by what we are going through. It's not that we've gone through it, we're still going through it. So the phrase that we've heard a lot of, we're in this together, completely, I think, applies in relation to our mental health and how the pandemic has impacted all of us. So we hope that you will enjoy Minding Your Wellbeing online. Again, to access it, you can do that through yourmentalhealth.ie. And I understand that the webinar, it's possible to access for anyone who wasn't on today, that it's still possible to access the webinar. And I'm trying to see, have I got the link for that? But maybe that's going to be on yourmentalhealth.ie, but we can send the link out to anyone who's registered for the event today so you can watch the webinar. So thanks again to everyone for participating, particularly to all our fantastic speakers who made the event so interesting. Thank you very much. Bye.